Tons of garments a day find their way into charity boxes. They're intended as donations for the poor. But most of the old clothes end up on the conveyor belts of private companies. Companies that sell them, mainly to Africa, the poor get zero benefit. Even worse, in Tanzania, cloth donations have driven the entire local textile industry out of business. Deepholz in Lower Saxony, Germany. Marita Schmidt has been sorting out clothes and wants them to go to a good cause. She's sure that donations to the Red Cross reach people in need. But do the clothes really go to those who have nothing? We follow the trail of the donated clothes. They're not picked up by the Red Cross, they're collected by a private company. These containers are emptied once a week, he says, and there's all sorts in them. This one's full nearly every week. Does the firm work for the Red Cross or on its own behalf? He tells us that the Red Cross is just a name. His company works as a subcontractor for IFIBA. 700,000 tons of old clothing were collected in Germany last year. 85,000 tons ended up at SOEX, the parent company of IFIBA. Around a quarter of it came from the Red Cross. Charity boxes like those of Malteser and the Red Cross fill up much faster than the containers of commercial collection companies, he explains. There's a big difference. Whether collections are commercial or for charities, everything ends up at the same depot. This is where we unload, our driver says. The clothing is loaded onto ramps and goes from here to SOEX in Wolfen. The ramps he mentioned are parked trailers belonging to the Dutch haulage company Vos. Several trucks a day set off from here, bound for the SOEX sorting plant in Saxony-Anhalt. So what's the deal between the Red Cross and SOEX subsidiary IFIBA? We asked the local secretary of the German Red Cross.
We have nothing to do with the contents of the containers. They're emptied by IFIBA. The company is also responsible for what happens to the clothing after that. As far as I'm aware, we have around 98 containers in place across the district. It would be impossible for us as a local Red Cross unit to empty them all ourselves. It simply wouldn't make economic sense.
Economic sense? We thought it was about collecting clothes for the needy. We drive to a neighboring district. Here in Osterholz-Scharmbeck, the Red Cross still apparently empties its clothes containers itself.
Many in the Red Cross don't do this anymore, but I don't know why. It makes sense because it helps people in need who can't afford anything else.
Wolfgang Huser has only been with the Red Cross for 3 years, but he believes wholeheartedly in the organization's work. And indeed, this time the journey ends at the German Red Cross Cloth Depot, where we meet local secretary Volker Leopold.
We give to anyone who comes to us. We don't check how needy a person is or how poor. Whoever comes to us at the German Red Cross receives clothes.
The shelves of the clothes depot are full, even too full, it seems. The truck moves on without unloading. The journey ends at a trailer belonging to Voss Logistics, the so-called ramp where the old clothes from Diepholz were unloaded.
What you see here was all collected today. The trailer is picked up once a week and taken to Eastern Germany, where the clothes are properly sorted. Anything that's serviceable then goes to disaster zones or other places where it's needed. And that is our incentive, the reason we do this.
The old clothing is sorted and then goes to a disaster zone. Does it really? We call again on local secretary Volker Leopold.
Forty years ago, no one at the Red Cross thought of collecting old clothes. But then one day, an entrepreneur turned up and presented his idea of collecting clothes in the Osterholz area. More than that, at the very first meeting, he wrote out a check for a sum of money that persuaded the Red Cross secretary to team up with the company in this venture. And we're still working with the company today, 40 years on.
We're told that the money received from EFIBA is used in line with the organization's bylaws to finance Red Cross work. But is that what the clothes were donated for? We drive to Bitterfeld-Wolfen to visit EFIBA's parent, the used clothes giant Soex. In the loading bay, more trailers from Foss. Their contents include clothes donated for the Red Cross. Paylak Imzikian is going to show us the world's largest sorting plant.
This is the unloading point, and you can see that the men are already busy unloading the garments. 400 tons of clothing a day arrive here, all of it from our subsidiary EFIBA and Retextil, which together collect nationwide. Retextil runs the commercial operation, covering the collection points outside shops and so on. EFIBA collects the charity clothes.
What brings more?
EFIBA, definitely.
The conveyor belts operate 24/7. Does the donated clothing that arrives here really go to disaster areas? The garments are sorted according to quality in massive hauls. A quarter of all the textiles come from Red Cross donations. The best garments are known as the cream.
This is where the trousers are sorted. And here we have the cream of today's batch. The cream goes mostly to Eastern Europe and the Middle East. Very little goes to Africa. Very little. There are various reasons for that. One is that the clothes are high quality and Africans can't afford them. They can't pay the price that garments of this quality fetch.
So well-meant donations become a shrewdly traded product. Only the inferior clothing goes to Africa.
It certainly won't go to Africa as a donation. That would be ridiculous. Economically, and from a sustainability viewpoint, it would be illogical. Soex is a full-profit company, not an NGO.
No, Soex is not an NGO and not a charity. But the German Red Cross is. We wonder about the terms on which the donated clothing is sold in Africa. We set off for Tanzania, one of the biggest customers for second-hand clothes in Africa. The country imports more than 20,000 tons of recycled clothing a month. Dar es Salaam. Most people here live on no more than a euro a day. The hectic 3 million city is growing fast. It's one of the most modern in East Africa.
Thank you.
We're told that nearly all the people we see in the street are dressed in secondhand clothes from Europe and America. On almost every corner, we see small traders trying to sell used garments. We want to know where the clothing comes from. Who are the companies making money out of garments donated in Germany? Together with our interpreter, we try to gain access, but the doors remain shut. We quickly realize that we won't get far on our own, so we talk to an insider who can help. Gottfried Mwenda knows his way around the textile industry.
I'd worked for the textile industry for the last 25 years until when the industry came under receivership.
Gottfried Mwendwa takes us to one of the biggest second-hand cloth markets in Dar es Salaam. In Tanzania, old clothes are known as mitumba. Here, the mitumba stretches as far as the eye can see. Gottfried tells us that most of the textiles here come from donations, many of them from Germany.
Some 20 years ago, some few textile mills were able to produce shirt material. But then with the decline of the textile industry, most of these who could no longer produce locally the fabrics for shirt materials. As a result, importation of these mitumba second-hand materials were again a substitute. As you can see, a wide range of here of these imported textiles.
No textile industry in the world can compete with clothes that come free except for sorting and transport costs. Gottfried Mwendwa gets us into one of the many small storerooms that the market traders use.
If the textile industry, the local textile industry, is restructured so that and revamped, so that actually the products that they are selling here as mitumba could be produced locally within our local textile industry. If that's not happening, it's really going to be difficult because mitumba contains diverse product range.
The clothes are still packed exactly as we saw them in Germany. Intermediaries have already made a profit from them, but no one has yet looked inside. The donated clothes have long been merchandise.
The poor people cannot afford buying these jeans at a high price, for sure. Of course, on the other hand, these second-hand clothing, it's generally true that the lowest quality would be only could be affordable with the poor people.
The port of Dar es Salaam, gateway to East Africa. Around 50 containers of old clothes a month enter the country here. Many come from Germany, packed with donations. We've been given a tip-off. A SOEX container is on its way to the country's biggest second-hand clothes dealer. Its journey ends at the Villamar company. The used clothes business in Tanzania is firmly in Lebanese hands. Hassan Gada spent 10 years in Germany. He shows us the Villamar warehouse. Second-hand garments are good business, he tells us, but so are second-hand shoes.
This is from SOEX over here. This is from SOEX. Yes, this is the merchandise from Germany. It's better quality than others. The Germans throw away clothes that are still good.
above all, it is still...
So people here like them. They sell well and make more money. German clothes are money spinners. It's as simple as that.
The Red Cross received around 5 cents a kilo for the donated cloth. Here they're sold for 24 times that. Hassan Gada tells us his company has sold 12 containers so far. This is high season, he says, and people are hungry for clothes. Uhuru Street, the city's main trading center for second-hand clothes. All the big merchants have their shops here, including Villa Mar. Its competitive edge comes from the garments from Germany. They fetch good prices, even among buyers from neighboring Zambia and Uganda.
This customer here, he said it's very big. I have my Germany, he likes it so much. Okay? This is a Germany one, mm-hmm. Okay? This is from another country, but he said it's very big, okay? He don't like it. He liked to Germany, he liked to, even if American, if it's a good quality, he can buy, okay? Sometimes, many people, he don't care for the money he paid. Because when you go to sell, he want to sell 111, so he can get profit.
Many here want to make money from clothing that was donated to help the poor. We visit one of the country's last textile companies. Godfrey has known the manager for years. The two take us into an empty factory. The production schedule on the wall shows no orders at all. Most of the machines are shut down and have been for a long time. Henry Mugeba is the manager of a dying business.
Since 20 years ago, we here in Rafiki, Friendship Textile Mill, we were about 6,000 workers here. But now, at present, we are only about 600 workers only.
Godfrey cannot conceal his dismay. The number of people employed by Tanzania's textile industry has fallen from 80,000 to 5,000, and the future is bleak.
A company like this one, which was contributing towards clothing the local population, it is failing its obligation. And of course, this gives an opportunity for Mitumba to grow and to flourish as a result.
The donations from the rich world have wreaked havoc in Tanzania. We move on, heading out of Dar es Salaam to Morogoro. Here we meet Kamba Maseline. The former executive wants to show us what is left of the textile industry. Over there, he says, was once the biggest textile mill in the country. At one time, this was a flourishing center of business in garments made in Africa. All that grows here now are weeds. The general manager had to lay off 9,000 workers. We gaze at the skeleton, at the debris of a shattered dream, at the dashed hopes of innumerable Africans.
Actually, the Mitumbas, when they came in, it was a big blow for garments factories. Most of the garments had to close down because most of the Mitumbas are coming in garments. And our own factories were affected because we are making also bed sheets. Now, if you compare, the price of Mitumba bed sheet is only 2,000, 3,000. But our bed sheet could go up to 6,000. So people prefer to buy these cheap clothing rather than buying from our own local manufacturers.
Komba Maseline is convinced that this business was ruined by the second-hand cloth from Europe and America. Today, the biggest textile mill in Tanzania is worth only as much as the stone in its walls. Men from the villages nearby earn a meager living from breaking it down to sell as rubble for the roads.
Now they are, have you seen, they're taking the bricks, they're taking the concrete, they're taking everything. You see, now we don't know. It's really very, 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 very sorry. You see.
Here in Africa, German donations became a nightmare for the domestic textile industry. The slums of Dar es Salaam. The people here live in desperate poverty. Many of them are the families of former textile workers. Their children wear mitumba, second-hand clothes from the industrialized world, because there is nothing else available. We want to know more about the unemployed textile workers. Godfrey takes us to the home of Yuma Atumani and his wife Alia. On good days, Yuma manages to sell a couple of chicken heads in the market. On bad days, the family of four doesn't even have enough money for rice. Today, they have to make do with tea, Alia explains. Godfrey acts as an interpreter.
It says that the situation was more or less the same, you know, the condition, you know, financial position of the family was relatively poor.
The simple tea is served up when the family can't afford rice, and that happens more and more often.
I have no hope for the future. I have no money left to feed my family, and I earn hardly anything from my small business selling chicken heads.
Godfrey takes us deeper into the slum. He wants to introduce us to an acquaintance who is even worse off than Yuma. Zainabu worked for years as a weaver. Now, at 55, she's jobless and ill. She receives only a fraction of her meager pension because her old employer went bust, partly because of donations from Germany. She shows Godfrey the paper setting out her entitlements. It's virtually worthless. Her only hope lies in the sale of a few beans.
Some beans, kind of beans here. Yeah. When she gets some money, she goes to see the doctor, and at times she receives some liniment or massaging, you know, medications for her legs. But when that is finished, then she keeps on, you know, waiting for another lucky day to come before she can go back to the doctor.
Every movement Zainabu makes is intensely painful. The former weaver lives with 11 other people in three small rooms. They paid the equivalent of 45 euros rent. Her own life is over, she says, but she sees no hope for the younger generation. Her young companion says she'd do any job, but there's simply no work. We drive back to the center of Dar es Salaam. Many have become rich here from the trade in second-hand clothes. The Villamar company has certainly flourished by selling the garments shipped from Germany by Soex. Ali Fawaz, the Lebanese owner, buys whole containers and sells them on at a profit of at least 10%. At first, Fawaz doesn't want to be interviewed, but in the end, he does agree to talk to us. He tries to play down the business he does in second-hand clothes.
Give away any shirt or trouser for free here, someone has to pick it up. So there's a transport cost here. There's a labor charge where someone will go and pick it up and bring it all the way to Tanzania, for example. You're paying taxes, you're involved in freight. At the end of the day, the end user collects an Armani jeans for a price of $2. If it wasn't for the guy who gave away the trouser at the first place, the guy who was in Tanzania, he couldn't have afforded to pay for that jeans at that price.
The reality is different. Fawaz charges the equivalent of €1.20 a kilo. The donated garments from the German Red Cross and other aid organizations arrive on the African market by the sackload. The small retailers, who are also hard-pressed, complain of rising prices.
There is a problem here concerning about this. You know, every day the price is raising, every day. But we can't actually afford to avoid them to raise the price because they are the owners and they are big traders who are brought in these days from Europe. Now we are suffering.
In the market, we meet a couple of seamstresses who used to work in the textile industry. They adjust XXL trousers to fit undernourished Africans. The women work on a piece rate basis, earning less than 80 euros a month.
Here we have ladies here who are doing some tailoring, but they're using raw material from Mitumba instead of using fresh textile material. As a result, this is due to the result of the collapse of the textile industry.
The volume of garments discarded in Europe has increased sharply in the age of cheap fashion. The containers fill up faster, and so do African markets.
You see these small children's wear dresses are here. Most likely they have been donated from Europe by European communities who, through good intentions, they would wish that such material reaches poor families in many countries like in Africa and places like here in Tanzania. So the worst thing scenario of which they don't want to see is that when this material come here, should be offered for sale instead of being offered for free as it was intended. So this is a very sad story. Yeah.
And it's charities like the Red Cross, Malteser, Diakonie and Caritas that help ensure that this sad story continues. Back in Germany, Berlin, the head offices of the German Red Cross are situated in one of the best areas of the capital. We are curious to hear what Red Cross President Rudolf Seiters has to say about the problem of second-hand clothes. Sadly, neither the president nor any other member of the board is prepared to be interviewed or even to comment on the issue of old clothes.
Yeah.
Despite repeated requests, Rudolf Seiters still refuses to give an interview on the matter. In his New Year's address on the internet, however, Seiters assured donors of complete transparency.
Dear friends of the Red Cross, I would like to draw your attention today to our international work, where we are particularly dependent on donations and where all donors have the right to know what happens to their money or the items they donate.
So why are people not told how the old clothes they donate are used to make money?
For you and for everyone who embraces the philosophy of Henri Dunant, to help where help is needed, I gladly light this candle.